إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. إنه من يهد الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وحبيبه. بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الله به الأمة وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. وبعد فإن أفضل الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة في دين الله بدعة وكل بدعة في دين الله ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار اللهم أجرنا من النار. My brother, my sister in Islam, I begin with the greeting of Islam. May the blessings and the peace and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be upon you. I continue and I begin by testifying that none is worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I continue by prefacing and by discussing and proclaiming and testifying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one worthy of worship and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the final messenger and a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whomever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides, none can misguide. And whomever is allowed to go astray due to their own wrongful actions, sinful desires and inclinations, none can guide back except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My brothers and my sisters, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep you safe, to keep you protected, to keep you in the best of ways. And I kindly remind you, inshallah, please, while you're inside, keep your masks on. May Allah bless you and give you Jannat al-Firdaus. My brothers and my sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals a beautiful surah, Surah Al-An'am, that comes to discuss very, very powerful, logical messages. For those who denied, for those who came up with excuses, for those who brought up arguments for the sake of arguing, and for those who were arguing because they were confused and they were looking for answers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses in the beginning of Surah Al-An'am a group of people that thought their iman would improve, or they would likely to become Muslim, or they would likely to believe in Allah if they were to see a physical sign. So these people, some of them were followers, and they were in doubt. They didn't know whether to listen to the elite in Quraysh, and they didn't know whether to listen to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They didn't have the capacity or the time to investigate Islam fully on their own. So they were wondering, looking for answers. And they thought, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-An'am, وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ عَلَيْهِ آيَةٌ مِّن رَبِّهِ. And he said, if only Allah were to send a very clear physical miracle or sign to Muhammad, then we would believe. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to them, and he says to Rasulullah sallam, وَلَوْ نَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ كِتَابًا فِي قِرْطَاسٍ فَلَمَسُوهُ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ لَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا سِحْرٌ مُبِينٌ. And they, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they say to you, O Muhammad, that they would like a sign, a physical sign. But even if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were to send down upon you a book from above, even if it were to fall in their laps, and this is written, divinely compiled, and they were to touch it, فَلَمَسُوهُ, look at the emphasis, they were to touch it, بِأَيْدِيهِمْ, فَلَمَسُوهُ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ, even if they were to touch it with their own hands, sooner or later, they would eventually look at that sign and say it was magic. So imagine the first time that it happens, or as soon as it happens, maybe some people would be shocked. Wow, this was incredible. MashaAllah, what a sign. I believe. But after a while, people would start to assume, wait a second, if Muhammad had the capacity to produce something like that, which is supernatural, isn't it more likely that that was actually just an illusion? That it was deception? That it was magic? So even if they were to see the biggest miracle and the biggest sign, sooner or later, their own rationalizations would kick in to justify what they've already presupposed and what they've already pre-assumed. So it's not what you see on the outside, it's what you're able to see through your internal compass. It's not your sight per se, it's your insight. If your heart is not in the right place, anything that you see, you'll interpret to suit your preset agenda, to meet your preset motivation. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala adds in the next ayah, responding to them, because we can assume that they said, okay, fine. You know what? The book, you're right.
if it comes down once, we're not even able to re-experience that event. We're not able to feel and touch it over and over again. But if you have an angel with you that is accompanying you, going wherever you go, then perhaps that will be enough for us to believe. So why don't you send an angel? Why doesn't Allah send down an angel? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to them when they say, وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ مَلَكٌ وَلَوْ أَنزَلْنَا مَلَكًا لَقُضِيَ الْأَمْرُ ثُمَّ لَا يُنظَرُونَ وَلَوْ جَعَلْنَاهُ مَلَكًا لَجَعَلْنَاهُ رَجُلًا وَلَلَبَسْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ مَا يَلْبِسُونَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds in two ways to them. When they say, okay, if a book were to come down only once, maybe we're going to say it's magic. We weren't there, not everyone was there. Maybe we're not going to believe the first people who witnessed it. But if there's an angel with you wherever you go, then we're likely to believe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds in two ways. The first is that if an angel were to come, you would make the claim that the angel is too perfect, that you cannot copy what an angel does or listen to what an angel says, because an angel is not like you. You're human, you have emotions and feelings, desires and motivations. An angel is perfect. So when the angel is seen walking and when the angel is seen leading, you know, to do something like prayer, whatever it may be, you're going to assume, well, I'm a human being, he's an angel. We do that with Rasulullah, we do that with the Sahaba. Imagine some of us say, oh, don't talk to me about Abu Bakr and Umar. I'm not like Abu Bakr. Don't talk to me about Rasulullah. I'm just a mere human being. So imagine if we talk about angels. And the second one, which is even more powerful, which is mentioned first in the ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that even if we send down an angel, they still would not change their attitudes and behavior. And that would necessitate their punishment. So out of mercy, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not send an angel, and will send instead a living miracle that changes them on the inside, the Quran. Pause for a second. The best example of this to understand better is, imagine those who smoke. When they pick up a cigarette package, they see on the cigarette package the picture of lung cancer. This is what will happen to your lungs if you smoke. Does that stop the person from smoking? It doesn't. Why? Because there's a craving that needs to be filled. Because there's an addiction that has been developed, a habit that has developed over time. So the person will rationalize, will say, you know what, that's what they say. Well, you know, my grandmother used to smoke, and they will say whatever to justify and rationalize. I have different genes, I'm okay, I'll live, it's fine. So they will rationalize because of the craving and because of the addiction and because of the precept, the presumptions. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, even if we send an angel, the angel will be there. A powerful message, but it's not going to change your behavior, because information alone, knowledge alone, does not change people unless they change their internal condition. And that's why the Quran is revealed as the internal message. Because the Quran is not just a series of logical arguments. Do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, move on. No. It begins with logical arguments and emotional arguments, and it fluctuates between the two. It argues with you as a human being. It converses with you. It scares you, allows you to feel the love and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It deals with every aspect of you as a human being. Changes you internally before it talks about the reality around you. So the message that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sending in the surah is that the world around you is in itself full of signs, if only you were to pay attention. What's the proof of that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ عَلَيْهِ آيَةٌ مِّن رَبِّهِ قُلْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَادِرٌ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يُنَزِّلَ آيَةٌ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ وَمَا مِن دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا طَائِرٌ يَطِيرُ بِجَنَاحَيْهِ إِلَّا أُمَمٌ أَمْثَالُكُمْ. And they say, why doesn't Allah send a sign upon us? Allah then says, He's capable of sending signs, but most of you don't know. And why don't you know? Because Allah already sent you the signs. Look around you, Allah says, وَمَا مِن دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Not a single beast or animal that walks on the ground or crawls on the ground, nor a bird in the sky that flies, soars high above you, except that they're nations like you. So you want to see the signs of Allah, look at the birds, look at the animals, look at the universe, look at the sun, look at the stars. There are already enough signs around you to show you who Allah is and what Allah is capable of. So the person who wants the physical sign, amongst all of these infinite signs around you, is like a person who's asking for a flashlight to be lit in the middle of the day. You're asking for a flashlight in the middle of the day. Why? Because you have your eyes closed. So you give me a flashlight. The sun is already there. The signs of Allah are already there. But you want the flashlight, thinking the flashlight is what's going to change. But in reality, your eyes themselves are closed. So the heart is close to the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not be impacted unless it itself intrinsically, internally decides to open itself to challenge its assumptions. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it very clear what is limiting Quraysh from believing. What is limiting people from believing? What is it really that's stopping people from believing? And the ayah is revealed here in 50, ayah 50 of Surah Al-An'am, which tells us that Quraysh, based on the ayah we'll see together, tells us that Quraysh said to Rasulullah, fine, you know, we're willing to believe, okay. We see that logically you're making great points. However, what does Islam guarantee us? Can you guarantee us power? Because we don't want to lose power. The reason why we don't want to become Muslim, the reason why we don't want to submit to the religion, or submit to the deen, or submit to the message that you're sharing, is because there's too much to lose. Power, money, an entire social system, an entire economic system, positions and prestige and privilege and titles, so much to lose. So what can you offer us? And this is the point of this khutbah. If there's one takeaway message today, it is this. Listen to this ayah carefully. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Rasulullah to say to them in response, قُلْ لَا أَقُولُ لَكُمْ عِنْدِي خَزَائِنُ اللَّهِ وَلَا أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبِ وَلَا أَقُولُ لَكُمْ إِنِّي مَلَكٌ إِنْ أَتَّبِعُ إِلَّا مَا يُوحَى إِلَيَّ قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الْأَعْمَى وَالْبَصِيرُ أَفَلَا قُلْ لَا أَقُولُ لَكُمْ I don't guarantee or promise you عِنْدِ خَزَائِنُ اللَّهِ I don't have the treasures or the keys to the treasures of Allah, so I cannot guarantee you wealth. وَلَا أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبِ And I can't guarantee you knowledge of what's to come, the future. So I can't give you wealth or guarantee you wealth. Nor can I predict the future for you. Knowledge capital. وَلَا أَقُولُ لَكُمْ إِنِّي مَلَكٌ And I don't tell you I'm a king or an angel, no! I can't guarantee you power, I can't guarantee you wealth, I can't guarantee you what's going to happen tomorrow. All I'm doing is revealing to you what has been revealed to me. إِنْ أَتَّبِعُ I'm simply following مَا يُوحَى إِلَيْهِ What Allah has revealed to me. And I ask you the question, can the blind ever be equal to the one who can see? هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الْأَعْمَى وَالْبَصِيرُ So meaning the Qur'an that I'm giving you, that is what is there to take. You know, sometimes, what we take from this message, listen to this carefully, in our rhetoric about Islam, we sometimes make very ridiculous claims that are not true. Sometimes we tell our kids, be a Muslim so that you'll do better in school. Be a Muslim so that you can get a better job. Be a Muslim so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give you power. Be a Muslim so that... And then we'll put X, Y, Z things material to the dunya. And the reality is, we don't worship Allah for what Allah does, we should be worshipping Allah for who Allah is. We don't come to Islam because there's another something we're looking for, we're hoping for. We come to Islam because we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that should be very clear in our submission. So don't say to people, become Muslim so that Y, Z, X can happen. No, become a Muslim because that is the best thing that you should be doing and you should be loving Allah for who Allah is, not what Allah does. Not to say that Muslim, good things will not happen. No, good things will happen. But we don't do things for the sake of those good things. When you become a Muslim and you worship Allah for who Allah is truly, you will learn discipline and love and compassion and mercy and justice. And that will make you a better husband, a better wife, a better father, a better son, a better business partner. Islam will impact every aspect of your life positively. But you don't do the submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because you're looking for those things. You do them because you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we talk about fasting and salah and siyam and we're giving da'wah, some of us fall into the slippery slope of saying fast because fasting is good for your health, fast because fasting is good for your wallet, you're saving money by not eating that much, fast because you feel the struggle of the poor, give zakah because giving zakah allows you to appreciate what you have and allows you to really appreciate the wealth and what it takes to give, and pray because it's a great meditation, a great exercise, good for your limbs, pray because it's good for your mind, because it's good for your psychological well-being. Go to Hajj because the biggest convention and biggest gathering of great individuals and great intellectuals. It's going to be a great opportunity for you to connect with so many people from all over the world. Great business opportunities. No, we fast because we love Allah and Allah said to fast. We pray because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us to pray. We give zakah because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us to give zakah. We go to Hajj because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us to go to Hajj. And we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we do all of those things out of love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not because there are benefits associated with them. And that is the true meaning of what it means to be a Muslim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Ibrahim and tells Rasulullah to say, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Indeed, my prayer, my rituals, my rites, my sacrifices, my living and my death, and everything that I do in between them is for Allah, the Lord of the world. La sharika lahu. No one is worthy of that association with me. وَبِذَٰلِكَ أُمِرْتُ. And that is what I'm commanded to do as a Muslim. وَأَنَا أَوَّلُ مُسْلِمٍ. This is what it means to be the best of Muslims. To submit fully to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And everything in between. To recognize there's honor in the individual, human being. But that honor is not intrinsic, it is through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the ultimate freedom in dunya. To be able to live in dunya and to appreciate dunya and to work with dunya, not because of dunya, but in the name of the one who made dunya. That is what it means to be a Muslim. And that is what it means to be free. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to live Islam, implement the best of iman in our actions and everything we say, and allow us to be people of excellence and ihsan. قُلْ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ سَائِرَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على المصطفى. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وبارك اللهم لنا فيما أعطيت. اللهم اهدنا وهدنا واجعلنا مهتدين. اللهم بارك لنا وفينا وعلينا واجعلنا مباركين. اللهم اقبلنا وتقبل منا واجعلنا مقبولين. اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت ولي مولاها. اللهم اجعل القرآن العظيم ربيع قلوبنا ونور صدورنا وجلاء أحزاننا وذهاب همومنا وغمومنا. اللهم ذكرنا من القرآن ما نسينا وعلمنا من القرآن ما جهلنا وارزقنا تلاوة القرآن آناء الليل وأطراف النهار على الوجه الذي يرضيك عنا. عباد الله، الله يحب العبد الإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. أقم الصلاة والصلاة زكاة تعلمكم من كتاب الله.